Now, previously we talked about finding the volume of a sphere, but maybe we want to do something else. Maybe we're after the surface area. Now, why would we want the surface area? Well, perhaps we want to cover it in something, maybe making a paper mache or out to paint something. So that's a perfectly good question to ask. And in fact, we could say, what's the total surface area? Aha, when we're looking for totals, that means integration. And of course, that means calculus. So let's look at the problem of finding surface area. So we're going to actually look at a very particular type of surface area. Namely, what happens when we take a curve, y equals f of x, and we spin it? So our basic picture is we have some curve, so there's our curve, and then we're going to spin it around some line. Usually we'll do it around an axis, but it doesn't have to be. And so when we do that, what will happen is that we'll form a shape. And then this shape, our goal is, what's the surface area? So how do we do it? Well, we do what we always do. Whenever we're trying to understand something, we say, let's break it up into small little pieces, little tiny parts, where if we can understand each little tiny part, then we can add them up together and get a good estimate for the total. So for instance, what do we think of doing? Well, instead of spinning the whole curve, what we can do is we can say, let's think about breaking this curve into little tiny parts. Now, the nice thing is that when we break the curve into a little tiny part, each part looks like a straight line. So what we can do is we can say, hey, if we understand what happens when we spin a straight line, if we can find that surface area, then we can say, look, I can tell you what's happening to the surface area of this little tiny piece. And then once I have the surface area of that little tiny piece, then I add up all the little pieces, we're good to go. All right, well, let's think about what we can do. So here's our sort of basic shape. We have a straight line, we've spun it around, and what do we see? Well, if you think about what's happening, it's really like we spun a part of a cone. You could extend these lines and say, look, here we have this part of a cone. Now, what are we going to do? Well, we want to understand area. It's a little bit more complicated when you think of it as a 3D thing. Area is a 2D thing. So let's lay it flat. So what do? Pull out our industrial strength scissors. We're going to cut it. So now we've cut this. And we're going to take it, and we're just going to go, lay it flat. Lay it flat. We'll have something in the plane, and we'll try to understand that shape. So what do we have? Well, what we have when we lay it flat is sort of something that looks like a pizza crust, that part right there. Now, what's this dotted part? Well, if we go back to the picture, that's, imagine if we extended it as part of the cone and we went and cut all the way down. So that would be the center. That would be the tip of the cone right there. Now, to help us figure out what's happening, we need to know something about little pieces of circles. And in particular, okay, we need to know about lengths and areas. So here we go. Some fun geometry. And they're both fairly simple to understand. So here we say that the area, so I'm talking about the area of the piece here, where I have a central angle of theta and a radius of r is 1/2 theta r squared. Well, why is that true? Well, here is the picture. Think of it as you have a circle. Here's the center, and we go out. So there's an angle theta here and a radius r. Now, what we can look at is how much area is inside that wedge as compared to the total area of the circle. So the area in the wedge, we'll mark that as A. Total area in the circle is pi r squared. In some sense, we can think of that as a percentage. How much percent of the area is in the wedge? Well, now let's compare it to a percent that should match up with it. Namely, how much did we spin around the center? So in other words, how much of theta is there compared to a full revolution? So we'll look at theta, and a full revolution is 2 pi. Now multiply the pi r squared across, You see the pi's cancel, and we end up with area is going to be 1/2 from that to there, and then there's going to be a theta and an r squared. So that's how we get the area. Now the other thing we need is to understand the length. So in other words, this part out here, that length there. So how do we understand that? Well, it's the same principle. What we do is we say, let's look at how much length there is in this part and compare it to the total length. So length over 2 pi r, well, that's the same as the angle, central angle, over 2 pi. And therefore, we get that the length is theta times r. Good. Done. So now we have our geometry. We're ready to understand our wedge. All right. So what are we going to do? Well, what we should think of this as happening here is that we really have a couple of things going on. We have this central angle theta. We have some length here, capital R, which we don't quite understand right now, but you know, we'll get into that. Then we have a little piece here. We're going to call that L. Why L? Well, the reason why we want to call it L is because it's the little length. It's the little length of what we spun. If we go back to our picture of what we spun here, this part right here, that corresponds to L. So it makes sense to say, oh, I'm spinning a little piece of length. It's good to understand what that length is. So this is our L. And now we want to say, well, what do we have? Well, our area will be the bigger piece, subtract out the smaller piece. So in other words, a big pi piece subtract a little pi piece. And so we just have to figure out, what are those? Well, we know how to find the area of pi pieces. That's our fact that we have here. 1/2 central angle, and then the radius squared. So here we go. For our shaded region, we have what? Our area is 1/2 theta, r plus l squared. That's the big piece. That's the large piece. Subtract 1/2 theta, r squared. That's the small piece. Okay, and so the difference, that's our little piece of like our pizza crust. Okay, so that's good. All right, now, a little bit of algebra. We square r plus l. So you get an r squared, an l squared, and a 2rl. So you know, 1/2 times 2, that cancels. Good. Phew, gone. Now, what happens here? Well, some great news for us. We've been doing some nice clean algebra, and the 1/2 theta r squareds cancel each other out. Nice. Good. Now, what are we left? Well, we're left with two things, theta rl and 1/2 theta l squared. So that's our goal. What are those two things and what should we care about? Now, here's the intuition here. We have two pieces, the theta rl, the 1/2 theta l squared. And what do we say? Well, look, l is supposed to be very tiny. So what can we say about l squared? Well, it's like very, very tiny squared. So the important thing is this part right here is very small and we can ignore. So we have, I know it's kind of weird to say some things are small and some things are very small. But the question is really what's driving the size? That's what we pay attention to. And then other parts, which when we look at them and say, look, they're so small in the limit, that it goes away, it's in the air. So this part is going to be so small because that L, that length, is going to be very small. All right, when you square it, it's very, very small. Okay, so very small, so we are going to ignore it because that's going to be essentially part of our error and the error goes away. That leaves us with theta RL. Now, if you go back to our picture, we say, okay, how do we handle theta RL? Because this angle, it's not so clear how to find it, nor this r. That's not so clear how to find that either. But we haven't used something. We haven't used the fact that the length of the edge is theta times r. So if I'm looking for theta times r, I can replace theta times r times this length here. And so we have this idea. L is the length. What is theta times r? Well, if we go way back here, that's this piece right there. It's the circle. Now, so I can say, okay, theta times r is the little circle that fits into this picture. So what is the circumference of a circle? It's 2 pi times the radius. So we're going to think of this part here as being some radius function, r of x. So that's our radius, r of x. So that's where this 2 pi r of x comes from. It comes from, hey, this is theta times r. So theta times r becomes 2 pi r of x. The length is the length. And now we say, all right, we actually know how to find the length, because that's what we talked about when we talked about arc length. That's the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared times our change in x. So this is the length of the little piece that we're spinning. R of x is how far is our little piece from where we're spinning. And then there's 2 pi, so because we want 2 pi times r of x to be the circumference. So that's the area of one little piece approximately. And it's a good approximation when we have L being very small. Now we add them up, because that's what we always do when we're dealing with integrals. Add it up. And when we do that, we get, hey, our surface area is approximately, adding things up, that's our sum notation, 2 pi radius square root 1 plus f prime of x squared times our change in x. Okay, so we go in the limit. As we make things smaller and smaller, our sum becomes an integral, because integrals are all about adding things up. And then we have 2 pi r of x and the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared dx. And there we go. So let's just review where all these things fit into our picture. So you can imagine we're spinning a curve. So there's our curve. And we're going, let's say, from A here, and there's B. So our curve is y equals f of x. Now, the way we think about whenever we're doing any application, we're just saying, what's happening to a small piece? So for surface area, we say, okay, here's our small piece. So it's just a small part of the curve. So we need to have the length of the curve, and so I'll make a little note here. The integral AB, I like to think of it as 2 pi. There's a radius and there's a length. So that this part right here, that's the length. And then this part is the radius. Now, what is the radius? And then that's the key question. Really, everything else is going to be more or less straightforward. And the answer is the radius is how far this piece is from where you're spinning. So suppose I were going down to the x-axis, because we could spin it around the x-axis. In that case, our radius would be just our distance down to the x-axis. Well, that's our value for y, which is f of x. So that might be what our radius is. It might be f of x. Or we could be spinning it around the y-axis. And if we spin it around the y-axis, what's our radius there? Well, it's the distance to the y-axis, and therefore our radius is x. Now, of course, we don't have to spin it around the y-axis or the x-axis. We can spin it around any line we want. And the moral is, we think about, take a little tiny piece, what's the distance to that line? That's what our radius will be. And so that's how we work the problem. All right, well, there we go. That's the idea. And now, time for practice. So let's go and do some problems.